So thank you all for turning out, and don't hesitate to adjust the volume if I start to blow you out. How many already know my story? A few of you? Well, that explains why you're here. Why are the rest of you here? No, that's... or vice versa, maybe. It is my pleasure to be here. I've already learned a few things about myself. You know, in the church world, you can't always be your real self, because people are expecting a certain level of success, spiritual success out of you. So, you know, you'll very quickly be labeled and sometimes ostracized if you showed up for service and the preacher's preaching about something that the sinners are supposed to be doing, and you were to wave your hand and say, hey, I've got a problem with that myself, you know, then things are going to be a little different. Probably you won't be doing your Sunday school class, you know, the next time around. Well, I confessed to not having a tolerance for alcohol earlier today, and do you know what I was told that I should do? I was told that I should start out drinking like a college girl. Do you know what it's like whenever you're about to be 45 years old and you're so naive to the real world that you're being told you should start your new life experiences out like a college girl? So, sounds fun to me, so that's where I'll be. So the bottom line always comes down to this for me. Anytime that I come to a new group, I'm always taken back that people are even interested in hearing our story and hearing where we come from and how this happened. I will tell you that I didn't mean for all of this to happen. I wouldn't trade it for the world, right? That's how old I am that I use that expression. I wouldn't trade it for the world, but I didn't mean for this to happen. My original intentions, whenever I realized that I was no longer believing exactly like I had been taught or exactly like I had learned to believe through both my childhood and adult experiences with Christianity, my initial thought was, this was the strategy. The strategy was that I would commit identity starvation. And that may sound a little... you know, a little strange or a little intense, but here's the issue. For 25 years, I had been a minister within a very small fishbowl, a very small community. The town that I was a minister in only has 10,000 residents, right? We don't call our counties, we call them parishes. And our parish, as far as the lines on the map are concerned, is a really large parish, but still yet, it's so rural that it only has 40,000 people in this entire parish. And so everybody knows everybody. And I had grown up as a minister. I started off when I was 17. I was saved at Jimmy Swaggart's church. Where the hell were y'all at 25 years ago? You know, you might could have saved a guy some trouble. And so I got saved at Jimmy Swaggart's church and immediately went into the ministry, and the type of religion that I had been born into, you didn't need theological education. As a matter of fact, they wouldn't let you go do that because, for some strange reason, people who went and studied theology would always come back more liberal than they started out. And so at age 16, 17, I was already in the pulpit. I was already preaching the Word of God, declaring God's Word, seeing visions, healing the sick, everything that you imagine that you've ever seen on a movie. That's exactly the type of world that I lived in. And that became my identity. That is who I was for this community. And you're going to hear me use the words community over and over for the next few minutes, because that's really the whole point of why I'm here. And so in this very small community, I had developed this role that I was playing. But the problem was, as it is in many cases, I didn't fully appreciate that what people were seeing and what I was thinking and feeling were two different things, right? I didn't realize that people were taking very seriously only certain aspects of my experience. So when they saw me behind the pulpit, they naturally assumed that I agreed with everyone else that got behind that pulpit. When they would go home on a Sunday evening and they would turn on their Christian television, they would just assume that what they saw on Christian television was exactly the same thing that I believed and that I thought. And it all meshed together. But unfortunately for them and me, in a lot of different ways, through the years, my thought process was changing. And that put me in great jeopardy with my community. Not just the 10,000 people, the 10,000 people, even in a town that small, so many of those people are strangers to you. But we're talking about the intimate relationships, the relationships that come home with you, the relationships of mothers and fathers and grandparents and siblings and even in your own home. There's a commonality that creates a bond, that creates expectation. There's roles that are being played even though we don't realize those roles are being played. And for some reason, somehow, even in the 21st century, in what is supposed to be the greatest country on earth that's ever existed throughout human history, somehow in the 21st century, we still are trapped in these roles. And I found myself trapped in this role. And eventually, I begin to be honest enough with myself that I could see that I didn't have all the answers. I didn't understand the math. I didn't have an answer for creation. I didn't have an answer for all the physical experiences and phenomenon that I had experienced and others experienced. I didn't know exactly how to explain the miracles that I thought that I had seen, but I did know enough to know that I wasn't believing what I had once been believing. And that I was now trapped in a situation to where those differences, just even though they were thoughts that were just bouncing around in my head, those differences were alienating me from the very people that I had dedicated my life to. And somehow I had come to believe that getting up at 2 o'clock in the morning and somehow trying to make this hair this beautiful at 2 o'clock in the morning, that somehow that going to the emergency room and sitting with people through a physical crisis or attending a painful funeral and being part of that grieving process or sitting through hours of counseling, I felt like that somehow by pouring myself out to these people that I loved, that they were connecting with the real me. But the fallacy there was that in these communities, there was just these roles that were being played. And those roles had expectations. And so once it began to dawn on me that I wasn't fitting into that role or that identity anymore, I realized that identity had to die. Because that identity wasn't me. The bottom line was that through my experience working at City Hall, being the mayor's chief of staff and the director of community service, all the way to pastoring two different churches, being the assistant pastor of several different churches, all of that had created this identity. And when someone said the name Jerry DeWitt, they didn't think about me. They thought about this other person, this caricature, this fictional character that bounced around in their mind. And I knew that person wasn't me and that the distance had gotten so great that to allow that identity to live would be to live a lie. So I backed out from pastoring. I stopped pastoring. I was still receiving numerous phone calls whenever someone needed someone to fill in a pulpit, when a pastor was going on vacation, if somebody wanted to have a revival service, if there was a special service, an anniversary service, I was still being called. And slowly but surely, I was getting more and more comfortable about lying about why I couldn't do it. And I would just say, oh, well, you know, I'm busy with this or this person's sick. I wouldn't tell them exactly why I wasn't taking it. But the strategy was that if I could just keep enough distance between the real me and that fake identity, then over time I would starve that identity to death. And 5 years later, 10 years later, after working a secular job, doing something completely non-ministry related, years later when people would say my name, they would think about this person and not about that person. And I would be freer to express what I was really thinking at that time. And because I'm such a genius, why would you laugh over that? I'm so insulted. Because I'm such a genius, the strategy was working well. It was working well. And then my great aunt figured it all out. and she began to post it on Facebook. An 84-year-old woman! 84! How does her fingers even work the keyboard? I don't understand. The mouse must be like this big. I don't get it. So she begins to post things on Facebook, and she begins to challenge me, and she begins to ask things directly, and the whole thing just begins to snowball. And before long, everybody in my family is finding out about it. And of course, I got a big family, and so then before long, everybody in town begins to find out about it, and I start to panic, because now my strategy, even though it was so well conceived, is not working out the way that I planned. And so I go to Facebook, this beautiful thing called Facebook. And at the time, I've only got a couple of hundred friends or so, and so I go through literally every single name, and I think about, and stay with me for a second, think about this for a second, I think about who the real Jerry is actually connected to, not this other identity. Because this other identity was connected to everybody, right? He was the preacher known by everybody, and the preacher who knew everybody. My wife, she hated to go to Walmart with me because just getting to the back of the store was 45 minutes, right? Stopping, stop after stop after stop, talking to everybody, right? Everything from praying for people to promising to patch a pothole, right? Because of both ministry and government. And so as the real me, I looked through those list of names, and my heart would resonate with different names, and I'd be like, yeah, we got a real connection. I need to talk to this person. And so I formulated this little letter. Now bear with me for a moment and feel the gravity of that situation. That I have been a minister in this community for 25 years. This is all anyone has ever known of me. Before I even graduated from high school, I was preaching revivals. And I'm now tucked away, hidden in the office in my home, on Facebook, composing a letter to tell them, these special people, that I no longer believe. And many of you have been in that exact same situation. You know exactly what it's like. And so out of about 200 people, I find 8 that matter to me, that matter to the real me. And I send them this letter. In the midst of those 8 folks, they vary in a lot of different ways, but in the midst of these 8 folks, there's this one special individual. This special individual happened to be gay in our little town of 10,000. And here I was about to bear the cost, to pay the cost of being so different in this religious community. I thought, if there's anybody on this list who can appreciate where I'm coming from, it's this guy who's been holding this secret, right? Not so well, or I wouldn't have known it, but has been holding this secret, right? Since we were in school together, been holding this secret. And so I know there's a bond, there's a commonality. So I hit send, and I send that little letter. And I kid you not, he put Aunt Grace to shame. He spread it all over town. I could follow his track across our town from office to office just by the friend request that I was getting. Suddenly, he would go, and because people would call and they would tell me, he would go to this office and he would say, did you hear about Jerry? And they'd be like, no. Well, you got to look on Facebook. I'm not friends with him. Well, send a friend request. He'll accept it. He'll accept anybody. He don't even believe in God. And he spread it like wildfire. Why? Because suddenly there was somebody more different than him in the community. That's the kind of community. And so I'm not going to be much longer, because I want to entertain your questions, and many times the story works its way out through your questions, and you ask better questions than I could anticipate answers for in my presentation. But what I want to emphasize to you is this, is that right now, we're at the beginning of a very, very special piece of history. we're building a community that will change the history of planet Earth. We're building that community right now. With just our attendance, we're making a difference. We all know what it's like to be trapped within communities that you don't fit into. Maybe like me, you realize that was not your identity anymore, and you had to move from just identity starvation all the way to identity suicide, right? Where you take that identity out into the public square and execute it and say, this is not me. I'm me, right? I know I still got the hair, you know. I know I'm still swaggering in the jacket, but still, that's not me. We all know what it's like to be trapped in those kind of communities. We have an opportunity that is far different than anything that we've experienced so far. We have an opportunity to build a community where people can come into it completely free from the pressure of false identities. And our challenge then, because people, whenever they leave out of that one community and they move into the next, why do they move into it? Because they've got all these things in common with these other folks, right? Well, hell, I thought that's why we were in this other group. Because we had things in common with these other folks. But we've got the ability to pitch a tent that is so wide and so all-encompassing that there's room for people to still find themselves inside our tent. They don't have to come over here with everything straightened out and everything figured out. Because there's freedom in the type of community that we're building. And if we'll continue to focus on that, if we'll continue to focus on ways that we can build a community where people are still free to have their own uniqueness, then we will set humanity free in a way that it never has been free before. There's been little sparks throughout human history of beautiful revelations of freedom. It's went in and it's went out. Politics will drown it out. Obviously, religion will do everything it can to suffocate those revolutions of individuality. But we've got an opportunity because the clay is still wet in our hands, and we are the individuals that are creating what the future of our community will look like. We have the ability to set humanity free, completely free, completely free, to where when they look back at today, today will be the dark ages. And you and I, we will be the light that was just beginning to glow. The power of the community is this, and it's so hard for me not to preach. I know you think I'm preaching, but that's because none of you were really saved. Oh! I've got a couple of fundies around here that could appreciate where we could go from here. Just give me, if I could just get the organist to come up. If Dan Barker was here, oh my gosh, the things we could do. The power of community. I thought I'd found a really special place in Des Moines, Iowa. Can you imagine that? I thought I'd found it with this particular church. My beliefs, my ideas were in such flux. I still had this Pentecostal background of speaking in tongues and healing the sick and supernaturalism and all this stuff, but I was beginning to move theologically towards predestination, Calvinism. And so I finally found this church that embodied those two very, very different forms of Christianity, and it felt like home for a little while. But eventually, I ended up having to leave for various reasons that actually is in a book that's just right up on the top of the... And so right before I left, I experienced my first legitimate, full-fledged panic attack. Anybody been privileged with a panic attack? Aren't they awesome? My family never believed me, but I would tell them, I would rather know that I have an open-heart surgery scheduled at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning than to know for a fact that I'm going to have a panic attack at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. That's how bad they are. And so the pastor knew I was leaving, but he didn't want me to leave, and it was all a cultist situation. And I'm sitting up on the platform behind him with all these other ministers. And I'm so intimidated and I'm so confused because I felt like God had led us to this church and my wife was now wanting to leave and everything is just a total mess. And little did I know that my nervous system had just been dragged down to nothing. And so it made for the perfect scenario for this panic attack to come. And the minister is preaching about people becoming demon possessed. You think that's a silly message or something? See, told you none of y'all were ever saved. And so he's preaching about that, and he turns and points towards me, and he says, anybody who leaves this ministry, in other words, leaves this church that he's pastor, leaves this ministry, will become demon-possessed. And I didn't know anything about how panic attacks worked before then, but I learned a lot in the next couple of years. But the mental image of me losing control and becoming demon-possessed was so frightening, and panic attack has a core in it of losing control, a fear of losing control. That was so frightening to me that I began to shake in the chair. Didn't even realize I was shaking. The minister sitting next to me reached over and put his hand on my arm and he said, Brother DeWitt, are you all right? And I said, no, I'm gonna go to the restroom. And when I got into the restroom, when I went to reach for the stall handle, my hand was shaking so much I couldn't move the handle. My body was trembling. I was completely filled with adrenaline, horrified, and went into my own version of hell for the next several months. Panic attack after panic attack after panic attack. So I'm winding up with this about community. And so, after a long search of trying to figure out what was wrong with me, late one night, watching a television I wasn't even supposed to own. If you know anything about Pentecostalism, you'll get that. No television, no movies, no secular music. All right. But watching a television I wasn't even supposed to own, at 2 o'clock in the morning, an infomercial came on about anxiety and panic attack disorder. And it was like an 18 cassette, you know, self-help booklet with all these cassettes. And the very first cassette was nothing but testimonies by people who had suffered with the same things that I'd suffered with. Not religious testimonies. Testimonies of having the same types of experience. And this is where my point comes together. Sitting there, playing that cassette tape. Does everybody know what a cassette tape is? Would someone go get a cassette? Break into a museum and get a cassette tape. Google it. Would Google even pull up a... Yeah. Fit to pull up a Commodore 64 to pull up a cassette tape, right? Huh? Can it? No. Okay. Listening to that first cassette tape and hearing those voices of those people who had suffered with the very thing that I was suffering with, it put me on the right path. Immediately, suddenly I realized, okay, I'm not devil-possessed, right? Okay, I'm not going crazy. All right, this is more physical even than it is psychological. This is about the nervous system. This is about food. This is about energy. This is about sleep. This is about stress. This is about a lot of things, but it's not about Jesus, and it ain't about God, and it ain't about church, and it ain't about doctrine. It's not about any of these things. All those things have played a part. But suddenly, that voice coming over that cassette tape, it gave me community. It gave me community. I didn't have it anywhere else. Everybody around me thought I was losing my mind. Everybody else was telling me, go to the psychiatrist. My grandmother was praying over me, day in and day night and out. And so suddenly I had a community because there was a similarity. There was a connection that was made. So, the point is this. As long as we create a community that values every form of individualism, then there will always be a voice to connect to the next piece of our community. Right? But as long as we're all angry atheists, then all we can connect with are more angry atheists. As long as we're all 5'5" pushovers like me, then all we can add to our fold is more 5'5" pushovers like me. But every single personality is a voice that will connect and create community for that other uniqueness. And that's what makes us explode. Can I get a Darwin? I will take your questions and I may preach afterwards. Thank you very much.